software engineer. I just work in the search team of Walmart Labs, mainly for the groceries. So before we go forward, I just want to go through the agenda of this talk. So we are just gonna start with the search engine, and then we will just talk about our talk that is mainly around the query understanding part. So we'll go deep dive into that. But before that, I just want to make some clarifications that we are just gonna use TensorFlow as a library for the deep learning, and it is heavily loaded with the deep learning only. So we are just constant to the this talk to the deep learning only, and the problem that is related in the search. So we'll just start this talk, and the first thing that I'm going to talk about is this search engine. So is there anyone who is from the search domain? Anyone from the e-commerce domain? Because we are just going to talk about more the problem that is related to the search engine in the e-commerce domain mainly. So no worry if you're not familiar with the search engine. I'll just give you a brief detail of the search engine. So what the search engine is look like is when you must have searched on Amazon or some other e-commerce websites. So this is what the search engine's results looks like, and I'm just gonna tell how this results we can make it more relevant and more personalized. So in the search engine, there are three steps involved. The first one is the pre-processing, the second one is the processing, and the last one is post-processing. So the pre-processing is where the search engine comes into picture. There are lots of search engines in the open source domain, like Solr and Elasticsearch are there. So these are the search engine mainly that is where the data is indexed, and then we are just going to search over that. But before our query goes into the search engine, we just need to do some pre-processing over that. So the user journey starts with the time that he clicks on that he searches something. So if user is searching something like Asirwad, Ata, something like that, then I'll just gonna briefly walk through the journey, how it goes through the engine, and then the result comes up. So the first thing that happened here is we just have to tokenize the search term in the form of words, and then we have to do the stemming and elementization over that. That we have just to gonna change the keyword, and then a spelling correction also needs to be done over here. And the second and the last one comes to the is a query understanding. That's what we are going to talk about more in detail. And then the last step is the post-processing, where the re-ranking of the result happens, that as the result is to make the result more relevant. So let's dive into the query understanding part. So the query understanding mainly is divided into two parts. The first one is the holistic understanding, where we are trying to find for a particular keyword in which categories it may lie. So, for example, in e-commerce, we have several catalogs. We have catalogs actually in which the several taxonomies are there. So, four or five levels of taxonomies are there, like category, department, self, aisle, and brand, and all. So, we just what our intention is here is just we need to find in which category it may lying. So, for example, if user is searching for 1 kg fresh, something like that, then we are showing that this search query has a higher probability of lying in a grocery and gourmet food department. So in that way, we are just gonna make the search more relevant and more refined actually. So I'll just take a live example of Flipkart, where if I'm searching for Levi's jeans, right? So I'm seeing here that Levi's jeans is lying in a men's jeans category. So in this way, we are just gonna give the user results much more relevant, and that only lies in the in that department only, like men's jeans only, not to show any other irrelevant results that may have a bad experience with the user perspective. So this is what the agenda of the first part of the query understanding is. So we will just see how this problem can be solved. So the problem statement here is that we are given a search query, and we want to find out in which taxonomy or category the search term may lie. So this problem is actually a multi-class, multi-level classification problem. So multi-level classification problem is that we are having a multiple classes that the search term may lie in several departments or in several categories actually. So we have to find in which the categories or department a particular search term may lie. So we have a multi-level classification problem. It means that a particular query may extend over several taxonomies and which are mutually exclusive to each other. So this is this means the multi-level actually, and multi-class, as everyone knows, that we are gonna have multiple classes, not the binary classes. Then the next, so for to understand this more better way, we're just taking an example like broccoli. So if user is searching for broccoli, then we are identifying that it is it has a higher probability of lying in a fresh vegetable category or department. In order to make the search engine result more relevant and more precise to the user. As similarly, we can see several other search terms are there, like cheese, MITV, apple juice, and Apple Watch. So in this way, we are just giving the user more precise result as he wants. So this problem can be solved by using deep learning solution. So we are using here NER as a solution. So NER is the named entity recognition, as everyone knows. Like a POS tagging is one example of NER, where we try to tag the sentences in a particular parts of a speech. For example, if a word may be a noun, pronoun, verb, and everything. So here we are finding actually the contextual embedding. So actually we are just using ELMO here. So ELMO is the first layer, because wherever the search engine starts is the search engine is starting with a query, and query has to be in the form of vector. So we need to get the vector of a particular query to start the modeling with. And for that we are choosing ELMO here. So there are several word embeddings are there, like word to wake, glove, or fastex are there. But we are choosing this ELMO as having several reasons are there. I'll just explain why I am choosing this. And then I am using here TensorFlow Keras API to just make it more easy to write the code. So TensorFlow has released 2.0. TensorFlow, where the Keras has been integrated in TensorFlow, so you don't need to install Keras externally. It is inside TensorFlow only. So I'll just walk you through the code in a very short time duration, as I don't have too much time here. So I'll just walk you through the code in a very high level. So I'll just start with the feature engineering. So what here I have is a search term, and so this is the search term, and then we are just gonna check in which category, department, self, or aisle it may lie. So those who don't know that the category, department, self, aisle means that this is how it looks like. So if you go on some website, any kind of e-commerce website, so if you will see here several types of taxonomies there, like food cupboard, rice, pasta, and then if you click inside that, it will get more narrower. So here you will see that pasta is there, inside pasta is spaghetti pasta is there. So I just need to come up with the probability of a particular search term lying in that categories. So this is our problem statement actually. Now I'm just going to explain why I'm using ELMO here, because ELMO is a very heavy model, and then we are just going to use it. So what is the relevant of using this? So as everyone knows that ELMO has a context on that. So what this context means is that I have let's understand this through an example. So I have a search term that is Apple, and then Apple laptop. So if I'll say ELMO to give me the embedding of Apple and Apple laptop, then here if the Apple is having an Apple juice, so let's say two search queries, that is Apple juice and Apple laptop. In both the search term, the Apple is present, but we are getting the different embedding for Apple in both the search terms. So that's what the context means, that for a particular sentence, you may get different embedding depending on the context of the word. This is the first reason. The second reason is that we may have several search terms which contains the other words like brands and other things that has not been trained using the other traditional models like Glove or Fastex. So we will be having a out of dictionary problem there, that we will not get the word there. But in this, by using this ELMO, the ELMO is actually created by Allen LLP. So they have used BI-LSTM network there to train the model, and then we don't have to worry about the out of dictionary word actually, because that has been taken care internally. So they will actually form a character embedding inside internally already implemented, and you don't have to externally use it. So that's the two benefit that we are getting actually here to use the ELMO as the first layer. So this is the code that we are using. So to use this Elmo, I am using TF Hub, the TensorFlow Hub, so the TensorFlow Hub is a place where all the models' code and its weights are shared. So you just have to download the code, and then you can use the pre-trained model without training and doing anything. So I just have imported a TensorFlow Hub as a model, and then I'm just using the Elmo module that is present already in the TensorFlow Hub. So this is the place where you can find all the embedding of the latest whatever the latest enhancement is happening in NLP domain. All the models like BERT, Elmo, all the models are present here. You just have to download it, and then you just have to import in the hub.module part. That's the part where you can get the embedding for a particular search term. So this is the first line of code where I'm explaining. I'm extracting the embedding of a code of a search term, and now I, in order to see how accurate is this, I have done some PCA or TSNE over that in order to reduce the dimension. So this is how it looks like. So if you'll see the cluster here, these are all the search terms. So the similar search terms are lying in a separate part. If you'll see that this is a cluster. So here you will see that a smart price yogurt, something is there. Actually, smart price is a brand. So all the smart price products are appearing here in a separate cluster. So all the similar search terms are together to each other so as to get the more relevant embedding for a particular search term. So this is how it looks like, the embedding looks like for a particular search term. Now I have used Keras functional API here. There are two APIs of the Keras, functional and sequential APIs. There are several advantages, disadvantages of both of these. You can read about more on the website of tensorflow.org. And so if the modeling part is concerned, I have used the input as the embedding layer, that is the Elmo embedding, and then one bidirectional LSTM layer, and then the dense layer followed by one last layer that is having activation function as a sigmoid, because for the multi-level classification problem, we generally use a sigmoid as a last layer. So this is how the network looks like, and we have using a loss function as binary cross entropy, and then Adam as an optimizer. So this is the complete network, and at the end we are having 2083 classes. Means I have 2083 number of taxonomies that a particular search term have. So 2083 categories we are dividing a particular search term in order to get the result more relevant in the terms of search engine perspective. So if you'll see the output of the model, I have trained this model on the data set that we already have in our search logs. So this is how the data set looks like. And I'm training this model over a GPU, because this is not Elmo and having lots of complexity involved there. So you cannot train it on single CPUs. I've already trained it. I just have kept a dump of that, so as to just show you all these things. So if you'll see the prediction here, so I have searched for Yorkshire pudding. This is a search term. So I want to know in which category or department itself, or in which taxonomy it is lying. So I have predicted one search term for that part as an example, and that is the output that we are getting here. So this is the food cupboard and having probability of 0.15. And then the baby, toddler, and kids having the probability of 0.10. Similarly, all the other category departments are having the probability for a particular search term. So this is all about the first part, that is having the holistic approach of the search, query search understanding, where we are trying to find the intent of a particular search term to make the search more relevant or more precise, to increase the precision of the search query. So this was the first part. Now next, we're moving to the second part. The second part is having query understanding the reductionist approach, where we are mainly will use NER, NER as a problem. So you might have seen some. I'll show you one live example on some website, like let's say groceries website. Big Basket is more popular here. So I have searched one search term which is chocolate without nuts. So I am finding a chocolate which should not have nuts. But what I am seeing here is not the chocolate here. So that's not a good user experience, and that's what we want to optimize and then use the search more better for the user. One more example I have is that I am searching for 200 ml real juice. But if you can see here, I'm not getting any 200 ml real juice on the Amazon website. So that's the problem of the query understanding. Second part, that is the reductionist understanding, where we are trying to find the entities in a particular system. So the reason that we are not getting any result here on the website that I've shown, the big basket on Amazon, is that the search engine is not able to identify the long tail keywords. So the long tail keywords is here that the search term having more than two or three words, like 200 ml, real, and juice. So 200 ml is quantity here. And then the real is a brand, and then juice is the query that user is looking for. So users, the search engine should parse this query in such a way that the search engine is able to extract that much the entity that user is looking for. So that is the problem with the search engine that we are trying to solve by using the query understanding. As this problem was there in our website as well, so we solved this problem by using this approach. So we also searched for nut free chocolate. So and previous result was looking like that, and then after applying this search deep understanding in the query understanding QoS part, we are getting this much refined result. So if you can see here, the chocolate is appearing here in the first response, and here some irrelevant result was appearing. So that's the problem statement that we are looking for, where we want to identify the brand, nutrition, size, quantity, etc. in a particular search term. So this is what the NER problem that I was talking earlier, that we have to find for a particular search term, like 200 ml real juice. I want to find that 200 ml is a quantity, and then real is a brand, and the juice is just a search term that user is looking for. This is the problem of NER, and then we are going to solve this problem by using deep learning. So another example I've taken here, that is just to make you more understand that what is the problem statement that we have. So we have taken one another example, that is nut-free Cadbury chocolate, where we are identifying that nut is a nutrition value, free is just a preposition, Cadbury is a brand here, and then chocolate is just a search term. So if we're able to identify this the entities in a search term, then the search engine will be able to give the result more relevant. That's the whole idea of using this. As a solution part, we have used here Glove as a word representation. For the word representation part, the contextual word representation is done by BILSTM. And then the last layer is having a CRF of convolutional random field. So this is a statistical approach to find a sequence of tags from all the possible ways that we have already a sequence. So this is how the CRF looks like. You can read more about the CRF on internet, and it's a kind of tagging approach which gives a sequence of tags for a particular entities for particular queries actually. So this model that I've taken is from the state of the art model, and it was just released in 2015, and it was the implementation was also done by one person here, and then I'm just extending this code here to provide the solution as a part of this problem. So the solution that we are having is that we are using here Estimator API. So Estimator is another TensorFlow API. As I told you in the beginning, that this is much more related to the TensorFlow only, as because TensorFlow has more benefit over other the libraries. That's why I've used much more TensorFlow code here, and we are gonna use the TensorFlow Estimator API to create this model. This model was created already by one guy that is, I have already shown that, and then I just extended this model for our use case. So this dataset looks like something that in that way, that we are having, this is the search terms, all the search terms, and then we have a tag corresponding to all the search terms. So if this is a search term, now I have tagged all the entities inside that search term, and I am passing this search term over this model. So this model is has used the first layer as a glove, so glove as have already described that it is so it was just word embedding. This is a way to extract the word embedding, and it is having a three dimensions. Several flavors are there. I have used the 300 dimension one, that the vectors, and then it was trained on 840 billion tokens, and on several data sets. So this is how the GLOVE model GLOVE actually looks like. And then if we'll talk about the modeling part, I have used this TensorFlow estimator. So TensorFlow estimator has a skeleton of having a model underscore FN function where we will write the code, the model details. Like for the first layer is having a GLOVE layer, and the problem that I was talking about with the ELMO was that it has out of dictionary problem, right? So in order to solve this problem with the GLOVE, we can use character embedding here. So if particular word is not present inside a dictionary, we can create an embedding of that word by using character embedding, and then we can append this word with the word embedding that is generated by the GLOVE. So this is done in this code. I am not going to explain all this line by line. It will take a long time to explain. So I'll just telling on a high level what is inside the code. So we are generating word embedding and then character embedding, and then concatenating both these together to have a final embedding. And then we are just applying one more BILSTM layer. And then at the end, we are having a CRF layer. And that's what the model looks like. And we have using optimizer as Adam. So that's what the model is. And we have trained again this model on GPU, as it has a very also a large number of parameters involved here. So as an example, I just want to show one example that is gluten-free bread. So it is trying to tag this gluten-free bread as what is expected. So this is gluten is a nutrition, and then this again free is a is adjective, and then this bread is a system, main system. So that's what about the model. This is the second problem that we had. So that covers all this, the current descending part in the search engine. Now we will look more on the perspective of having a model in a production. So the problem that is being faced by most of the people while using the deep learning is that they are not able to make it to the production. But here at Walmart, we have make it into the production, and the simple thing that we have used there is that we have used the TensorFlow serving actually. So the TensorFlow serving API is actually the main key to make the code in the production. Now let's know more about the TensorFlow serving API. So this TensorFlow serving API is just a wrapper that is written by TensorFlow.org again, and it has a saved model API. So which just loads the model graph and parameter both at the runtime, and it can show you the result as in the form of REST APIs. So it is using gRPC as a protocol internally, and also the Docker as a container in order to make it to the production. So we are using the Docker TensorFlow/serving as a base image for this part. I can show you the code here also that is being used for the making it in production. So we are just pulling the TensorFlow/serving module. And then we are done with the model name and all the details. And we are at the end, we are having an endpoint from where we can get the result of a particular prediction. So this is how we can make it in the production in a very easy way. So that's what the talk is about. You can get all these codes, whatever I have shown you, in the Jupyter notebook. On my GitHub link, you can see it. I have just posted all the Jupyter notebooks except the dataset. That cannot be shared. So I have just put this Jupyter notebook on that GitHub. And I have a Medium link also. I used to write a lot on Medium about deep learning, mainly around the deep learning in search. So you can read it more about that. All this query understanding and all these parts I've already covered there. I have started mainly on the TensorFlow part there. solution. So that's what the whole talk is about. If we do have any question, I'm happy to take it. Yeah.
I have a couple of questions, actually.
Yes.
So first was, if I understood it correctly, when you talked about the named entity recognition for finding out the search term from a phrase, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So you said you use LSTM to train a system to be able to tag words as a search phrase or adjective or something else, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how, where did you get the tag data? So did you generate the data or you already had the data?
Yeah, yeah. So we actually generated some synthetic data was also there, and some data was also there from the logs.
Okay.
So we have logs that user as user engagement data also we have. So user is clicking on that and buying which product. On that part we can get the tags.
Okay.
And also we have synthetic data that we use to generate some search term that is not user's search actually.
And the last question is, when you have a lot of intents and when you get like, you know, approximate values, like this is maybe 0.15 possibility is this, 0.16. So you have some weights, and do you apply some kind of thresholding, like, you know, this has to be at least this much for me to be able to confidently say what it is? And when you add intents, do you keep on changing this threshold? How do you measure an optimum threshold? How do you calculate it?
Yes, so as this model is concerned, we have only only the model that is having accuracy of around 98% or 95%. So we don't have to bother about most of the cases where the search term is having where the accuracy is very low. The accuracy will be low in very limited cases because the accuracy is already very high. So we can use the threshold or whatever value, like 75% or 80%, but we have not used any limited over there. Yeah. So is there any other question?
Yeah. One question here. You have used you have used binary cross entropy.
Yes.
While doing a multi-class classification. Any particular reason?
Not the binary class classification. You mean the loss function?
Yes.
Yeah, so the loss function is the log likelihood here.
No. In the first problem statement.
In the first problem statement.
Yeah, you have used a binary cross entropy because usually that increases the accuracy.
Yeah.
So it's a trick we use to increase the accuracy. Is that the reason you have used binary cross entropy? Ideally, it should be categorical.
Yeah,
or
should be categorical cross entropy. But the data set is like that only. So we use the categorical cross entropy as well, but the binary cross entropy was suggested as we have trained on both the loss functions. So first we consider this categorical and then the binary as well. So whatever we have got, the more accuracy on that we have used. And ideally, it should be the categorical cross entropy that will be used.
Okay. You have used character embeddings for out of vocabulary words.
Yeah.
So you have trained character word embeddings, or you have used pre-trained character word embeddings?
No, we have trained the character embedding. So if you'll go through this code that is here, you will get to know how the character embeddings being generated. So for each and every character in a word, we have a embedding for that. And then we have trained a bilstream layer as well to generate the embedding of a word in that.
Okay. Yeah. So you use character embeddings only for words which are out of word, out of vocabulary?
No, not only the out of word, but for each and every word.
Okay. And for words which are not, which are out of vocabulary, you don't use word embeddings, or you take them as zeros?
No. We use word embedding along with the character embedding. So we used to concatenate both these embeddings.
So there will be no word embeddings for out of vocabulary words?
No, right? There will no word.
So you take it as zeros, or?
The default value, that is the zero, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
For the last layer, mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, because in the case of multi-class and multi-level classification, the sigmoid is because we don't have to. So this is a multi-class problem, but we also have to generate so this particular system may lie in several categories as well, several classes as well. So multi-class problem is that we have more than one classes in the prediction. So it may be two classes, three classes, four classes. So if we'll take the softmax, then how will we decide the top four or top three categories there? So
mm-hmm.
So that will tell. But in the softmax, what is happening is you will get the higher values
for each class.
Yes. So you will get the probability for each class, but it will give you with the sum will be one, right? So the sum of all the classes will be one. So in that way, we'll not be able to say in which, because it will not be accurate as well, because the sigmoid doesn't sum up it to one. It just gives the probability irrespective of the other classes. So softmax depends on the other classes as well. So for example, if a class has probability of 0.9 and another class has probability of 0.01 or 0.1, then it is dependent on other classes. But if you'll use the sigmoid layer there, then it is independent. It is independent of other classes. Like it may have value of 0.9 for the first class and then 0.89 for the other classes as well. Yeah, because it doesn't sum up to one here at the last. Sorry? GitHub link. Yeah, the question.
So when there is no context, when customer asks a question, right, say for the search results, right, how do you provide a contextual search results to the customer?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. Yeah.
So for example, customer is searching something which doesn't have context mm-hmm. at all. Basically, the key intention of the customer is not captured in what they are searching for.
Yes.
How do we provide relevant results?
No, we are capturing already, right? So we are tracking each and every users from the backend. So we collect the data first and then we train this model. So we have collected this data for 6 months or 7 months, past 6 and 7 months, and then we have seen the user engagement in which product he is most interested in. Mm-hmm. And according to that, we have come up with a model training and all that, after that only.
Okay.
So we already know what is the intent of the user beforehand training the model.
In case of new customer, right?
Yeah.
So how we provide a contextual search?
Yeah, so the new customer will have the similarity between the other customer that is there at the beginning, right? So we'll find the similar customer to that on the basis of profile, and then we can say what is the intention of that user.
So it's come. I mean, there is no historical data, right?
We have historical data. That's what we have trained on. So no, we extracted the data from the user past history, and then we have trained this model on.
Suppose if there is a problem where there is no historical data, so you have a search engine. Just say that there is a date. You have 10 documents.
Yes.
Text documents.
Yes.
And so. You have to build a search engine. If I have asked a question, and it should just give me related paragraph or something from the document. So at that time, I will not have any, and there is no historical data.
We already have the historical data. Actually. This is the presumption actually. So in the search engine, we index the data that is in catalog. So this is the present data in the search engine. The data is there. That is not the past data, historical data. It is daily indexed and daily stored in the databases. So whatever they use from backend team like Merchandiser or whoever is operating this website will keep on updating the data, right? So that with there it is getting changed, but the user history is something that we are keeping it fixed for a particular duration of time.
Okay. So for this particular problem, do we have any suggestion to how to
Which problem?
Like the problem I'm asking you. So there is no historical data.
Yes.
So I just have to search in all the documents and get the relevant text. Or the results, top 10 results for that particular search term.
Yeah, we can do so through the search engine, right? We can just have to index that data and then just get the top 10 result, that's it. So we just use any Solar or Elasticsearch, any search engine, it will be fine to give the top 10 documents.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think that's the part from my end, guys. Thank you.